from Mark's Gospel. This is Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll need it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" The disciples told them what Jesus had said. The people allowed them to take the colt. Then they brought it to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and Jesus sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. There was a young boy named Marco. Marco was walking home one day on Mulberry Street, near the intersection with Liz Avenue. Marco could remember, as he walked home, his father's advice from earlier that day, saying, "Keep your eyes open, Marco, and see what you can see." So Marco did as he walked along Mulberry Street, kept his eyes open to see what he could see, and what he saw was a horse and a wagon. But then it seemed to him, maybe it wasn't a horse and a wagon, maybe it was a zebra, or a reindeer, or an elephant. And maybe it wasn't a wagon, but a chariot, or a sled, or maybe a cart, carrying a whole brass band. It was a parade. The stands along the roadway, and confetti coming down on them, and magicians, and even two people of Asian descent, described in the book in a way that has prompted the publishers to withdraw from distribution of a lovely book, a lovely story nonetheless. And as Marco got home, he rushed up the stairs to tell his father what he had seen on Mulberry Street, and he stopped. Tell his father all of that. Maybe thinking it was too much, or his father wouldn't believe him. And so when his father asked him what he had seen on Mulberry Street, he says, "Nothing but a plain horse and wagon on Mulberry Street." And as readers, we are left to guess what it was that Marco saw. Think now about young Eliezer and Esther walking home on the road to Jerusalem from Bethany, remembering mom's advice to keep their eyes open and see what they can see. And they saw, as they walked along that day, a donkey and a rider. And they saw, as they looked closer, people who were on either sides of the roadway, waving green branches and throwing garments under the path of the donkey and singing songs as the donkey and rider went in. They imagined that maybe this was a welcome for a humble pilgrim because their cousin Hawaii had told them that that's how you welcome people with legs around them. And in Jerusalem, they didn't have that, so they waved greenery instead. And so when they were asked when they got home, what did they see? They said, well, nothing but a humble pilgrim. But others who watched that parade and listened to what was going on, they heard and saw other things. The religious authorities heard songs that quoted scripture that didn't describe the entry of a humble pilgrim, but rather someone who was making a claim to divine authority, a Messiah, and sonship, and that was blasphemy. The Roman guards, who were also in the area, saw things as well. They watched the garments being thrown in front of the path of the donkey, and they said, this is not a humble pilgrim, but someone who is making a claim to earthly authority. Someone who is claiming to be a king. And that is a threat to the empire. And so we now, as readers, are left to interpret. And yet we know, those of us who look back from this side of the cross, we don't have to guess at what Jesus' intentions were or what it was that others saw. We know, because we know that everything about Jesus' ministry is about to culminate in this moment. Jesus knew what he was doing, and his disciples would know soon. And so now, on this Palm Sunday, we find Jesus beginning the inevitable journey to the cross in a carefully orchestrated triumphant entry where Jesus, the Word made flesh, being led into Jerusalem in a highly ritualized parade as the fulfillment God's redemptive purposes. And we know also that at the end of the week, by the time that we are done with Holy Week and we are in the Passion, we know that the same voices that were singing Hosanna on Palm Sunday, loud praises to God, will be crying on Friday, crucify, crucify. Jesus, the Prince of Peace, who ushered in the kingdom of God, would lay down his life on the cross. Self-sacrificial love for all the world. We read in verse 1, as they approached Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples and said, go into the village, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. This is a staged event. We know that it was at a particular time, in the fullness of time, at a particular location, the Mount of Olives, which happens to be the place at which, if you were intent on conquering Jerusalem, you would want to enter into the city, which wasn't lost on people, with a pre-established signal in place for the disciples who were sent off to gather a donkey to find that, with a signal, why are you taking it? Because the Lord needs it. And sure enough, they bring Jesus the colt, and they throw cloaks on it, he sits on it. And we have to ask ourselves, why is he now sitting on a donkey? Someone who has just walked everywhere, was he all of a sudden tired for the last mile into Jerusalem? The bulk of this text, as we read it, race to the parade, right? That's the fun part. But the bulk of the text, we just gloss right over and, oh my, what's happening there? That's boring stuff. He
And you think it's boring stuff, it might actually be less boring than you think. This is laying the groundwork for the triumphant entry. Text that reveals to us a previously developed plan. And if that's true, that should make us take pause to think about anything else in the event that might appear to be spontaneous. Such as verse 8, many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches, and those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, Hosanna. All burst into spontaneous song like a Broadway show. Or people had been gathered for that purpose. Like if you have ever been to Washington, D.C., when there was a parade, and you know that the people there bust in from wherever they were coming, the same kinds of places you all come to worship today, bust in by event organizers who handing out the placards for them to wave and the chance for them to practice and learn so that they're all on the same page. Water stations and porta-johns all brought in to care for the people who were there. Jesus had an advance group for the triumphant entry into Jerusalem. One for the gathering of the donkey, another for when he entered into Jerusalem to sing those songs, quoting those passages from Scripture that were certainly heard by those who he knew would hear them. Palm Sunday, in this sense, if we look at the text this way, we realize that it's actually a bit of what we would today call street theater, which is something that's been around for a very long time, an intentional display or powerfully presented and intentionally prevented show of subversion. Jesus is lampooning the political order of the day, and he's presenting some satire for the religious authorities of the day. Coming not as a mighty warrior, but one who's vulnerable. One who is come to proclaim a kingdom come where the rich are brought low and the lowly are exalted. One who knows his fate and dares to call out the oppression of those who perpetuate that system. Not with pomp and wealth himself, but identifying with the poor. Not to assert authority, but as one who rejects human authority. Guaranteed to provoke a response, which it certainly did. Verse 11, Jesus enters Jerusalem, he went into the temple, and when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. We're expecting, aren't we, at the end of the triumphant entry, something to happen at that moment in Jerusalem. Jesus has told the disciples that he must suffer and die and be raised. But Jesus didn't tell them about anything else that was going to happen that day in Jerusalem. No intent to do more than there was. Nothing more at that time. No acts of violence, no destruction of property like when he had been there and had turned over the tables of the money changers and driven the animals out. No civil disobedience. This was not occupied Jerusalem. And nobody prevents Jesus and his followers from entering. Nobody cites them for not having a parade permit. Nobody gives him a warning for disturbing the peace. Jesus enters Jerusalem, goes to the temple. He looks around, checks his watch, sees that it's late, and goes to Bethany. But the next act has already been set in motion. The upper room, the Last Supper, the arrest, the trial, the crucifixion, the death, the tomb, and the discovery that Jesus is no longer in it. The subversion is just beginning.